Welcome back, guys. This is the second episode of our ACLS series on stable tachycardia. Our patient is Rodney Lee, a 56-year-old male whose chief complaint is heart fluttering. He drove himself to the ED after he experienced this heart fluttering, so let's jump right in. So we're going to ask what happened.
What happened? My heart is fluttering, but I feel dizzy.
When do the symptoms manifest?
I don't know exactly.
Do you have any allergies?
No, I'm not allergic to anything.
Do you take any medications?
I take a fluid tablet and something for the palpitations.
Any medical problems?
Yes, I've got some heart problems.
Is there any pain?
No, I don't have any pain.
Now we're going to gather more objective data. These tabs are set up for the airway breathing and circulation, or the ABCs of healthcare. So we're going to work left to right. We'll start with a pulse oximeter so that we can get a SpO2 and a heart rate, hook up a 3 lead and pads, get a blood pressure or BP, start an IV,
the IV is inserted, flushing.
Get a blood glucose, draw labs, and then finally check an EKG.
96.6 milligram per deciliter.
So let's slow down now and look at the ACLS algorithm. This info can be found on page 140 of the American Heart Association's ACLS Provider Book. So the AHH says this is how you can classify types of tachycardias in order to diagnose and treat. We will need to answer these questions before we proceed. So are symptoms present or absent? Yes, symptoms are present. This is why Mr. Lee came to the hospital today. Are symptoms due to the tachycardia? Yes, cardiac output is determined by stroke volume multiplied by the heart rate. We already can tell that the heart rate is elevated from our vital signs showing a heart rate in the 120s, but stroke volume is the amount of blood pumped out of the left ventricle with each heartbeat. In this case, the patient has atrial fibrillation, and the atrium, or top two chambers of the heart, are not effectively moving blood to the ventricles, or the bottom chambers. This means the top chambers cannot fill the bottom chambers, or that the preload is low, which decreases stroke volume. The stroke volume is insufficient in this case, leading to a decrease in cardiac output. Is the patient stable? Yes, the patient is stable right now given their current subjective and objective data. They are alert, orientated, awake, and only have a complaint of heart fluttering with no apparent signs of distress. For the remaining questions, we have to look more closely at the EKG, but first we're going to do a quick review. On page 139 of the ACLS Provider Book, you will find the following info. We need to determine if we have a narrow or wide QRS, and if we have a regular or irregular rhythm. So let's take a look at the EKG. Each of these little spaces or boxes on this 12-lead EKG is 0.04 seconds. So if we measure one of these QRS complexes, we can see that the QRS is less than 0.12 or smaller than 3 of the boxes. We can also tell from all the scribbling that there is not a definite P wave and that the QRSs are not regular or evenly spaced, indicating atrial fibrillation. Consequently, let's go back to our original questions. Is the QRS complex narrow or wide? We now know that it is narrow or less than 0.12. Is the rhythm regular or irregular? We can definitely tell that it is irregular. Is the QRS monomorphic or polymorphic? It looks polymorphic here because there's so much electrical activity from the atrial fibrillation. Is the rhythm sinus tachycardia? Nope, this is AFib. So all the questions are answered at this point, and we can use this info for subsequent diagnosis and treatment. Now we will continue to the adult tachycardia with a pulse algorithm. Bubble 2 here asks if we have a patent airway, which we do, and his SpO2 didn't indicate that we were having trouble. It then asks for us to identify the cardiac rhythm, which we have as AFib. So now we will advance to Bubble 3 per the instructions. We do not have hypotension, altered mental status, shock, chest discomfort, or heart failure in the current clinical presentation or medical history. Now we will go to Bubble 5, and it asks if we have a QRS under or over 0.12, and since it's under, we will go to Bubble 7. We have already obtained IV access. We could have tried vagal maneuvers, but we should continue to read. We could give adenosine, but since the rhythm is irregular, we shouldn't, or we will cause potential harm to the patient. But finally, we can give a beta or calcium blocker. Both beta and calcium blockers are considered negative inotropes, meaning they weaken the strength of heartbeats. However, both beta and calcium blockers slow down the speed of the heart as well so that the heart chambers can fill with blood. This increases our preload and stroke volume, which will increase our cardiac output. This will treat our patient's cardiac issues medically, so let's give 5 mg of metoprolol tartrate in this case. Note how high the heart rate and BP is and how it will change after we administer the metoprolol tartrate. Additionally, since AFib results in poor flow of blood, there is a tendency for the blood to clot or form embolisms. This is why AFib and embolic strokes are strongly correlated. As such, we need to thin the blood with aspirin so that we can prevent clot formation that could lead to a stroke in the future. So we will give 325 milligrams of aspirin PO. We will do a quick head-to-toe assessment. Auscultate the lungs, heart, and abdomen to see if we discover anything else. Now that this is complete, let's see how the patient is feeling. Since they feel better, let's transfer them to a medical ward. As you guys can see, we did very well in this scenario for our first try, and we were not given any alerts to indicate we had performed incorrect or inappropriate treatment. I hope that this video will help you in your practice or perhaps your personal understanding. Please provide feedback in the form of comments, likes, or by subscribing in order for all of us to determine how to improve clinically and perhaps provide more content you would like to see regarding nursing. Till next time, stay safe.